3, 2, 1. Yo, what's going on, guys? It's Ryan here, and welcome back. Well, actually, welcome to a brand new podcast that we're going to be doing called Lunch Table Talks. Everybody knows the great arguments and discussions that you have at the lunch table, and I decided to bring that to a podcast right now over Zoom due to coronavirus and also just scheduling constrictions. So we're going to get right into it. We're going to open up with a classic lunch table talk segment, and it's called LTTOFP, Lunch Table Talks Official Football Picks, where we're going to be going over the football games this week, the big games, and we're going to be reviewing who wins, who loses, and why not. So, first game that we have on the ballot here is the Ravens versus the Eagles.
No shot that the Eagles win.
Yeah, I'm gonna be completely honest with you. This game's going to be a blowout. It is – the Eagles are just going to just destroy. They're going to go out there, and they're going to light up the Ravens' defense. They're going to – Ravens aren't going to know how to stop Carson Wentz.
Amen. It's facts, though. We all know Ravens – I don't even think Eagles are going to score. I'll be real with you. I don't.
Dude, they're going to score. They're going to score. Travis Fulgham is a monster. Travis
Fulgham. He's going to have 2 TDs, my prediction. Picked him up in fantasy this week. You better get 2 TDs.
It's just
a fact. I'm scared that we're going to get screwed over by Lamar Jackson. Usually, you know, linebackers are supposed to stop quarterbacks, and our linebackers are absolutely garbage.
I completely agree with you, Josh. They're terrible. I mean, Singleton's okay, but Nate Gary, Jerry.
Fucking.
Literally, I think I should go out there. I think I would cover better than him. I mean, like, did you see him get cooked on that route for Claypool? Like, that was just disgusting. He hit him with one move, and Gary, like, almost fell flat.
He didn't want smoke, man. He didn't want smoke.
He didn't want to fucking win. That's what he didn't want.
I think he's betting against whatever team he plays against. All right, so next game we got up is the Giants versus the Redskins. Now, Ethan's a G-Men fan. Ethan, what is your thoughts on that?
I say Giants, they're winning, man. I'm rolling with them.
You're rolling with the G-Men.
They ain't talking. I got these 2 touchdowns.
I got to go Giants, too. I don't think Washington's, you know, been very very special lately. And, you know, the Giants almost beat the Cowboys last week, even though, you know, yeah, it wasn't with Dak. But even when Dak was still on the field, the Giants were still up. So, I mean.
I think they were leading when Dak got injured.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to go with the Redskins here. I think with Alex Smith at quarterback, I think they got a little more inspiration. They got a little more drive to do well. I think Gibson's going to have a big weekend just because Alex Smith is going to be doing a lot of dink and dunks and just picking apart the Giants' defense. Now, the Giants do have a great corner that has been locking down top receivers, as Ethan told me. Ethan, what's his name?
Bradbury.
Yeah, Bradbury is just – he's an absolute shutdown corner. He held Amari Cooper to 2 catches. He held Allen Robinson to 3 catches. He's doing really well. So Terry McLaurin's going to be taken out of the game. But I just don't see the Giants' offense producing anything. I mean, they haven't been able to get anything going. They scored a lot of points this weekend against the Cowboys, but it was a lot, you know – one, it was on defense. You know, you had that one pick six. And the other scores were all because they were just running the ball on the terrible Dallas defense. And the Redskins defense isn't half bad.
Yeah, actually, their D-line is pretty solid.
Oh, yeah. It's Chase Young. I thought Chase Young – is he –
yeah, he's back. He's back. He was back last week.
Yeah, I think it's definitely going to be good. I think it's going to be a good game. I mean, it's going to be as good as game an NFC least division could pull out, but –
I agree with that.
I think it's going to be a solid game. So next up, we got the Browns versus the Steelers. Josh, what's your thoughts on that?
I mean, after seeing, you know, the Steelers this week, I mean, they've only beaten bad teams, but, like, it's also the Browns, so I think I got to go Steelers here.
Wow.
I mean, you know, last week they lit up, you know, with wide receivers, and I don't think, you know, the Browns can really cover Juju, Claypool, and, you know, all the weapons that the Steelers
have. And you have Denzel Ward.
Yeah. I don't know.
But they can only stop one. It was like with the Eagles.
Yeah, exactly.
They were able to stop Juju, and then Claypool went off for 4 touchdowns.
And even then, Darius Slay covered Claypool on a couple of routes, and Claypool still burned him.
Claypool's good. He's a big guy, dude.
Fast.
He's big and fast. I think I'm going to have to go with the Browns here. I think the Browns right now are just – they have such a high-powered offense. And the Steelers really haven't faced a great team yet. And I think the Browns aren't a great team, but they're the best team that Steelers are going to face. And I expect the Steelers to come out a little flat-footed at the beginning. And, you know, not really expecting that level of competition to step up like that. And Steelers take that game. I'm not Steelers. Browns take that game.
I agree.
And final game for Lunch Table Talks, official football picks, is the Tampa Bay versus Green Bay game. My opinion is going to be an absolute shootout, and I'm hoping it is because Aaron Jones and Aaron Rodgers is on my fantasy team. So I need some big points and big production from them. But I think it's going to be a great game, but I got Green Bay winning this. I mean, I don't think Tampa Bay has really shown an ability to be consistent against great teams. They lost last week against Chicago on Thursday night. Does Brady still have it in him? He has something in him, but is he really, you know, at that peak ability to be able to carry a team through a shootout? Maybe. He did it week 3 against the Chargers, or week 4 against the Chargers. I forget which week. But I don't know. It's going to be a high-scoring game. Both teams don't have the greatest pass defenses. It's going to be a good game.
And you got to remember, Tom Brady is going to be against a bad man, like Steve said. He's low-key on MVP season right now. Aaron Rodgers?
Oh, 100%, man. He is.
Like, he's getting underrated. I'll be honest with you.
Nah, Aaron Rodgers, he's killing it. I saw there's this one thing is like top scoring offenses so far this year, and it's like the top 5 just in points, right? Green Bay, even though they didn't play a week, is still number 5 in the league for most points scored. And they're only like 16 points behind first place. That just shows that their offense is so high powered. And it all starts from the man under center.
I think the Packers are the better team, but I think in this case, it's going to be one of those games where the lesser team, you know, plays up to the competition and gets the upset. I could definitely see Tampa Bay coming into this game and just going all out and just, it's still going to be high scoring, but I think Tampa Bay runs away with it earlier, and neither defense gets stopped. So I don't think the Packers D is, you know, all that good. So, you know, how are they going to stop Tom Brady with Mike Evans and Chris Godwin?
Chris Godwin's back.
I think he came back this week. Yeah,
I could definitely see that happening. I mean, it's going to be. I could see Green Bay coming out flat off a bye week, and just absolutely, you know, falling behind early, then that's when it turns to a shootout. But Tampa Bay uses that like 14-3, you know, lead that they may have to start to like keep a little.
And I think they got Shady back this week too. I think he returned to practice. I don't know if he's gonna play, but
questionable still. He is still.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, that'd be a good 1-2 combo, the running back with the wide receivers. I mean, I could see Tampa Bay pulling out like some crazy like 41 to like 30 something.
So. That's good that you brought up running backs. That's a good segue into our next topic. We're going to be talking about Le'Veon Bell. Le'Veon Bell is a hot topic in the world of football right now. Le'Veon Bell, for the viewers watching, just recently got released by the New York Jets. New York Jets, worst run franchise probably in the league right now. Worst team in the league right now, probably going to go 0-16. Le'Veon Bell just got released. Now he has 3 teams on his mind. Miami Dolphins, Kansas City Chiefs, and the Buffalo Bills. So I want to ask you guys, what's your thoughts on this whole situation? Should teams really even, you know, take a chance on Le'Veon Bell? And 3, where do you think that he's going to go?
All right, number 1, absolutely. I think if you're a fantasy owner, you should as well. I think there's going to be the Adam Gase effect. I mean, Adam Gase is trash. Anybody leaving the Jets, they're a much better player and much more, better fantasy option for it. So 100%, I think you should buy low on him. If he's on the waiver, pick him up. And I think he's going to sign with Miami or the Bills. Because hopefully, I have clock. Imagine, hopefully, He doesn't go with the Chiefs.
The reason why Ethan is saying that, guys, is because Ethan just in our fantasy league just traded for Aaron Jones for Hilaire and Le'Veon Bell. So if Le'Veon Bell went to the Chiefs, it's not.
I could definitely see him going to the Chiefs. I feel like him and Andy Reid would absolutely go off.
Oh, 100%.
And that would 100% complete the offense. I'm not saying that Edwards-Helaire, you know, isn't the guy right now. Like, he's been playing pretty well. But I think that Le'Veon Bell would just be that added superstar and just complete the offense.
Le'Veon Bell takes that team to another level.
Exactly.
Even just a little bit of what he was back in Pittsburgh.
I don't think he's at that same level. I think he has died down a little bit, but he's definitely still top 10.
No, I think he could definitely still be really, really good. But he's not going to go back to that Pittsburgh Steelers level. But I do think that Kansas City is the best move for him. Not just, you know, team fit-wise. He's guaranteed to make a deep playoff run. Playoffs and have a chance at a Super Bowl. I mean, when you're looking at, like, where to go, that is what you want to look at. You want to say, all right, I need to win – and I need to be able to fit in the offense. And those two, Kansas City literally is a perfect fit for him.
He deserves that deep competition.
Exactly.
And when he was on Pittsburgh, like, they weren't, you know, the best team. They made the playoffs, but, like, you know, they never really went anywhere with it. If he goes to Kansas City, he can, you know, go deep.
And then next up on my list, I think definitely it's Buffalo. I think Buffalo is a great running back away from being a super contender in the AFC. I mean, they got Stephon Diggs, Cole Beasley as their wide receiver core, two really solid guys. Josh Allen's putting up an MVP season. The Bills' defense is something to be messed with, unless you're the Tennessee Titans. Then, you know, you just could kind of run over the Buffalo Bills or truck over the Buffalo Bills' defense. And I think third is the Miami Dolphins. Now, that's just not me being biased because I have Myles Gaskin on my team. And if Le'Veon Bell goes to the Dolphins, I'll probably cry. But that's not it. But I just think there's no fit there. I mean, they have a solid –
what does he have to play for there? What does he have to play for there? Like
you're playing for – you're fighting for a playoff spot. You know, you're not even guaranteed one. You're in the AFC East with the Buffalo Bills here running away with it right now, and the New England Patriots. It's a tough division to be in right now. And I don't think that somebody wants to be in there.
I think a stat that I saw that was kind of ironic was the fact that the Jets' next three games are against the Dolphins, the Bills, and the Chiefs. If he decides, like, today or tomorrow, I saw something he could decide as soon as today. Like, you know, he could already be playing his former team.
Adam Gase sucks. All right, next topic. Just recently, going over to NBA real quick. Just recently, the NBA Finals finished. The man holding up the Finals MVP trophy and the Larry O'Brien was the man by the name of LeBron James. Does this put LeBron James as, you know, into that, you know, greatest of all time category in the sport of basketball? Does this ring really solidify him being the greatest of all time, or does he still need to do more to really put his name in forever history?
I don't think – this might just be my opinion, but I don't think he can do anything that'll make him surpass Michael Jordan as the GOAT.
The next, like, seven rings?
I mean, he's not going to be in the league for that long. I mean, like –
who knows?
Assuming he plays for two or three years – like two or three more years, or maybe like whenever his contract's up. Like, yeah, if he wins Finals MVP every single year, like, you know, maybe. But like, realistically speaking, like, you know, next year if they don't make it to the finals, or next year if they lose in the finals, like, I don't see him surpassing Michael Jordan as the greatest basketball player of all time.
Honestly, I don't really see anybody in the East that can really contend with a lot of people in the West, unless if Giannis goes to the Heat. That would be scary.
And for me personally, I think LeBron James was the GOAT even before he won this championship.
I agree.
For one reason.
I could disagree with you there.
That man has carried bum teams in the finals.
almost every single year that he's lost. Look at the teams he had to carry back in 2007. Name me his best player in 2007. His name was like Ilgauskas or something. Name me his best guy in 2015 after Kyrie and Kevin Love went down before the finals really even began. Kyrie got hurt in game one of the finals. Kevin Love in the Eastern Conference Finals. Matthew Dellavedova was his second best player.
He went off that series, though.
What?
He went off that series, though.
And lost! He scored 36 points a game, averaged a triple-double, and lost. 2016 completed the greatest comeback of all time, 3-1 comeback.
Against the greatest regular season team ever, 73-9. That's
2017. They need to form a all-time team with Kevin Durant, Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green, Andre Iguodala, Sean Livingston.
Booker is the coach.
To beat one person, LeBron James. Then, 2018. Tell me who LeBron James' best guy is against that same exact squad.
It's the Henny God, obviously.
It has to be J.R. Smith. It was actually Jeff Green, probably. Tell me this man carrying all those guys while Michael Jordan had the best lineup around him and always had the best team in the league because he had the greatest front office of all time, one of the greatest coaches of all time, the greatest sidekick of all time, the best rebounder of all time. He had everything going for him, and when things weren't going his way, you know what he did? He retired and walked away from the sport while LeBron James stayed through all the adversity. Never. Oh,
he was too good at basketball. He had to try something else. That's all it was. He wasn't getting that competition anymore. He wanted to try something else. He couldn't handle the pressure. He did that after he won three straight finals. He
couldn't handle the media. LeBron James, the most scrutinized athlete in the world. And you know what? You don't hear a single thing bad about him in the press that he has done.
And that is one thing. Nobody's ever had this much expectation and just weight on their shoulders.
Think about Josh.
He was Sports Illustrated at age 16, and he lived up to the hype. That is unreal.
You are a sophomore in high school, and there is 3,000 people coming to your basketball games, and it's getting televised on ESPN2. And if you make a single mistake, the whole world is going to have it on video for the rest of your life. Imagine that pressure. And he overcame that and just –
He developed early. He developed early. You know, players are still developing in high school and college. He just developed early. And, I mean, yeah, he hasn't, you know, lost anything. But, I mean
– I think the best case for LeBron being the greatest of all time – now, if there was a hypothetical fantasy draft of all players in their prime of all time, I think LBJ would go first. He can play in any system – under any coach, under any second best player, it doesn't matter. He is the best. He's one of the best passers. He's one of the best scorers, and he's not even a scorer.
Michael Jordan's a better scorer, though, dude. I got this.
Yeah, exactly. I think MJ's a better scorer. LeBron is not the greatest scorer, but LeBron.
Okay, but what about this? What about
this?
This
like?
Defense wins championships. Michael Jordan's defense is like no other. He would lock up the number one player on any team, and he would just dominate on defense. Defense wins championships, and that's why he's, like, probably the greatest player ever.
LeBron James locks up Jamal Murray in the Western Conference Finals. LeBron James locks up Paul George and Kawhi Leonard. See, LeBron James doesn't defend the main guys anymore. One, because he's 36 years old, and he needs to have all his efforts because he carries the entire team on the offensive side of the ball. Did you watch the finals? When LeBron goes out, the other team goes on 8-0 runs.
He is an exceptional defender. He's gotten a lot better in recent years. The Lakers, they have a much better defense.
He has the most iconic defensive play of all time.
That's true.
But
James.
LeBron James at the rejection. But, Josh,
Michael Jordan.
I guess we're going to agree to disagree. And – next up on the topic, we're gonna be looking at some football again. We're gonna go into injuries. So just recently, Dak Prescott's injury, extremely sad. You know, he had a compound fracture with his foot, completely broken, needed emergency surgery for it. It was a really sad injury, really powerful, emotional moment. My question for you guys is, what do you think is the next step for football to cut down injuries?
I mean, I don't really think there's anything you can do. I mean, like, especially talking about Dak, like, there's nothing you can do about that. It was just a freak injury. It was just, you know, it just happened the way he fell on it and the way the defender fell on it. And, like, with all these injuries, like Christian McCaffrey and, like, Saquon Barkley, like, you know, there's nothing that the NFL could have really done any different. It's just the way their leg twisted or the way, you know, they landed when they cut. These injuries, like, yeah, there's been a lot of injuries this year. And, you know, some people have, you know, connected them with the fact that preseason was cut out and training camps were shorter. But I don't think a majority of these injuries just happen to be, you know, freak accidents that can't be controlled.
You see, I think that is true. But also I think there's a lot of injuries that could have been avoided if they had a preseason and proper, like, training session, like, before the season, because they had a very short training camp. They had no preseason. I think that would have got them much more in shape. Obviously, you know, like, with the Saquon injury and other injuries, like, there's no way you can avoid them. But I still think that for, I would say, roughly, like, 25% to half of them could be avoided.
All right, so I'm about to drop a fact on you guys. This season, do you think that there's been more or less injuries?
I feel like there's been
less. I feel injuries, like, there's been
this, but I feel like it's about who they had the injuries.
I feel like it's been the same. It's just bigger, notable players are getting injured more.
So that's the exact stat, that the injury rate is pretty much the same right now. It's about the same amount of injuries going into week six as there was last year. It's about the same. You know, it's the same proportion with the preseason, without the preseason. The main difference is that these big-name players are getting injured, and that is what's really hurting the NFL, because all these big-name guys are getting, you know, ACL tears, like season-ending injuries. Christian McCaffrey, Chris Godwin hurt for a little bit, Saquon Barkley, all these big-name guys are getting injured. I personally think what you're going to be seeing a lot of, especially with teams that have just a lot of money, is doing what the Las Vegas Raiders did, and they're going to be going away from turf and going to grass fields. Because I think that's the one – if you look, you know, you could do stuff for all other types of injuries. You know, you could do stuff for ankle injuries, ankle sprains. You could do stuff for all different types of injuries that could prevent injuries, correct? Something you can't do anything about – is tearing ligaments, like an ACL tear, an MCL tear. Because while these guys are getting progressively stronger, faster, more mobile, those ligaments never get stronger. So either one is next. Either one, they're going to try to find something that can improve the strength of those ligaments or the flexibility of those ligaments. And two, you're going to see a lot of people start going to grass fields.
I agree. And also, one thing I had to say, Saquon is going to come back crazy this next upcoming year. I can tell you that. He's going to have an AP year. Come back here.
I hope, man. He's a great player.
Comeback player of the year.
It's going to be him and Dak. I can tell you that.
Yeah, it is.
That'll be interesting to see.
That is going to be a battle.
That would be pretty cool to see.
So, final question for today, guys. You know, I want to keep these podcasts about 30 minutes. Is looking forward to next season. What do you think is going to happen? Who do you think is going to win the finals? This is a huge – who knows? The NBA finals may be still a year away. We don't know when the season's going to start. But outlook of the season right now, what are you guys thinking?
I mean, I don't want to be one of those people that are just like, oh, you know, the Lakers and Heat are going right back to it, because, you know, just that's just what we saw this past season. But I could see the Bucks, like, they've got to get something done. Like, they have so much talent. Giannis has been going off every, like, these past few years. I feel like they're going to be able to pull something off and actually make it all the way to the finals. I don't know if they'll win the finals, but I could see a Bucks versus Clippers finals next year.
Wow.
Honestly, I have to say that if Giannis stays, I don't think he gets the championship. I don't think he gets out of the East. I think the Nets are going to come back pretty strong. I think that the Heat, you know, they're young, solid squad. I don't think they're going to go back to the finals. But on the West side, I would definitely say L.A., both teams, the Warriors, and, yeah, that's pretty much it.
I'm about to drop something on you guys.
Go ahead.
The Lakers are going to make it out of the West, okay? LeBron James, Anthony Davis, nobody's stopping them. But there is one team in the East that is going to make it out, right?
I was going to say the Sixers.
They're tall. They're fast. They're going to have a point guard that could shoot. They're going to have one of the best big men in the league. My prediction
for the team that's going to make it out of the Eastern Conference is the Philadelphia 76ers. Without a doubt, the Philadelphia 76ers are making it out of the Eastern Conference and winning the championship. They got Ben Simmons, Doc Rivers, Joel Embiid, Matisse Thybulle. They got stars on stars on stars on stars. They're going to get it together. Brett Brown stunk. If Brett Brown, if we had Doc Rivers this year, we would have won the championship.
More like they would have only won one game.
I feel like they're definitely going to be able to make a deep playoff run next year, but I don't see them beating both the Heat, the Bucks, you know, the Nets. The Nets are going to have KD and Kyrie. That's going to be a deadly combo.
We'll see how that.
I don't know. I mean, Doc Rivers is definitely going to help. They're definitely going to improve from last season. And they're not going to be another first-round exit. But I don't see them making it out of the East. The East is stacked, you know, maybe not compared to the West, but the East still has that, you know, shit ton of competition that, you know, I don't see the Sixers making it out.
I would love to see a Lakers and Nets finals. I think that would be great.
That would be cool. That would be a good finals. Kyrie and KD versus LeBron and AD. That would be an awesome finals.
Yeah, I would love to see the LeBron, KD, and then LeBron, Kyrie. I would love to see him go back and forth and defending it.
That would be dope.
Yeah.
That would be good.
So
I think I don't know if the Nets have enough supporting cast, though, to help them get there.
Yeah, because, yeah. I mean, outside of those two, I mean, it's basically like – the Harlem Globetrotters team.
But then again, outside of AD and LeBron, who else did they have? You know what I mean? In the NBA,
Danny Green.
They did have Rondo and KCP. They both showed up big time. Yeah.
The NBA is so star-driven. I mean, the Nets have Caris LeVert, Spencer Dinwiddie. They got some guys who could play, and that's what you need when you have stars. If you have stars on your team like Kevin Durant and Kyrie, they're going to take up all the attention. They're going to be getting 60 points a game between the two of them. The other guys just need to score the other 10 guys in the roster just need to score 50 to 60 points a game. You know what I mean? The NBA is still star-driven. So, but, yeah, that is going to be episode one of Lunch Table Talks. Thank you guys for coming here. Any final words you guys want to say? Any final thoughts?
Go Birds.
LBJ's the GOAT.
MJ. MJ all the way.
All right, well, we were doing good on some, like, positive, you know, final words, and then he threw out MJ's the GOAT. But, yeah, guys, that is going to be it. Thank you so much for watching, if you watched all the way through. We're going to keep on pumping these out. I like doing this. I like talking about sports. I like podcasting. So, once again, thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you guys in the next one. See you guys.